I'd like for everybody to turn in your Bibles to the book of Habakkuk. You're probably going, what? Habakkuk? You will find that it is one of the last few books in the Old Testament, so it's to the left of Matthew, and you will find it between the books of Nahum and Zephaniah. We're going to be looking at Habakkuk. Would you join me in a word of prayer? Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come here today and we're thankful to be here. I am thankful to be in a place, in a nation, where I've had the freedom to proclaim you. But we are thankful for those that have served in your armed forces. We're thankful for those who have sacrificed much so that we can have much. But Lord, I am very much aware that we are living in troubled times. And Lord, it is incumbent upon us, as your people, that we need to be a people of prayer. The air we breathe is really not the insanity of this world around us. But for your children, it is your very word. It is your truth. And though we may call ourselves a free nation, the reality of it is you, Lord, who have set us free. We shall know the truth, and the truth shall set us free. And if the Lord sets us free, then we are free indeed. And that is true, actually, whether we're American or Chinese or Iranian or whatever. If you have set us free, we are truly free indeed. And so, Lord, I pray that you will speak to me today and help us to be encouraged. Help us to be thankful. Help us to know that you are God, you are sovereign, and you are still on the throne. In your precious name I pray, amen. You know, this weekend, actually for several months now, I have been troubled, as many as you also have. And on Monday, we were looking at ahead as to what would happen on Tuesday, and I was still deeply troubled. And there's a lot that we can be discouraged about. There's a lot we could be depressed about. And as I was thinking on Monday, I had two really big reasons why I could be depressed and discouraged. And though I would like to say I'm thankful that the election is over, we are not out of the woods yet. In fact, we are far from it. We live in a divided nation. We live in a troubled nation. We live in a country that seems to be sliding rapidly down a slippery slope of immorality and amorality and worse. And again, I could get real discouraged, but as I was sharing in my prayer, the air I breathe is really not the insanity of the world around me. It's the Word of God. And I already had another message all ready to preach. Actually, I was ready to preach it last Sunday. So I thought, oh, okay, I'll preach it this Sunday. And on Monday, God led me in another direction because as I was breathing in the Word of God, I came across this beautiful Old Testament book. You know, a lot of times we think about the Old Testament and we think, oh, man, you know, that's old. It's not very relevant. You know, it doesn't have a lot for me. Well, yeah, it does. A lot more than we think. And so we're going to be looking at this beautiful book of Habakkuk today. Now, I'm doing something, again, a little different. There's no PowerPoint. You're probably wondering, where's the PowerPoint? Well, there's none. You're probably wondering, why didn't the pastor put blanks in that I could write in? Because there aren't any. It's not that I was lazy. It's just we're going to talk through this beautiful book of Habakkuk. And so I have really very few notes. I have a lot of scripture. So we're going to talk about it. And we're going to see how relevant this book is for us today. So let's begin. Now, I'm going to be reading in the New Living Translation, but I encourage you, follow along in your translation. And the reason I'm doing the New Living is because I really want it to speak to our time. I want you to hear it as maybe we would say it today, as we would hear it maybe from God's lips today. So in verse 1, It says, this is the message that the prophet Habakkuk received in a vision. Now, as we've been looking, we've actually been looking at several of the minor prophets already. And as with most of them, we really don't know much about them. We don't know anything about Habakkuk apart from this book. It appears that he was a prophet to the nation of Judah. And based on his prophecy of the Babylonian conquest that was yet to come, biblical scholars have placed this writing most likely around the 7th century B.C., and with this estimated date, Habakkuk is probably a contemporary of the prophets Jeremiah and Zephaniah. And it's also likely that he lived to see the prophecy of the Babylonian assault on Judah actually lived out. He probably was an eyewitness to that. But what is really fascinating about this book, and one of the reasons I think it really will speak to us today, is that it is a dialogue. It's a dialogue between a prophet of God or a man of God and his God, the sovereign ruler of the universe. How many of you are asking questions right now? How many of you are maybe having a dialogue with God and asking, God, how in the world did this world get so messed up? I mean, what in the world is going on? You know, how did we end up with such an insane election? How did we actually end up with such an insane government for the last few years? Why is the Supreme Court doing what it's doing? Why is there so much terrorism? And I could go on and on and on and on. And we have questions. We want to know what's going on. We want to know what's happening. Well, you know, what's interesting, as much as things are different, things are not that different. Habakkuk also had some very serious questions for his God. He wanted to know about God's ways. He wanted to know about the world he was living in. Now, we may be in a different century. We may have stuff that's different than maybe what they were dealing with then. But just as God answered Habakkuk, so I believe God answers us even today. He has answers for us. The question is, are we looking? Are we looking in the right place? Are we listening to our God? Do we hear him? So let's look. Let's look at verse 2. Habakkuk is writing, and he's saying, how long, O Lord, must I call for help, but you do not listen? Violence is everywhere. I cry, but you do not come to save. Must I forever see these evil deeds? Why must I watch all this misery? Wherever I look, I see destruction and violence. I'm surrounded by people who love to argue and fight. By the way, have you seen any of the images on TV this week since the election? I mean, is this a testimony of our times? Habakkuk could be writing this right now. And here's what he says in verse 4. The law has become paralyzed, and there is no justice in the courts. The wicked far outnumber the righteous, so that justice has become perverted. He was living in a wicked time. He was living in a difficult era. And so are we. And so are we. And I think many of us may have said, maybe using different words, but we've cried out something very similar. Look at verse 5. The Lord replied. God has an answer. He says, look around at the nations. Look and be amazed, for I am doing something in your own day, something you wouldn't believe even if someone told you about it. You know, just because we don't see God at work does not mean he is not at work. The fascinating thing, what Habakkuk is going to learn, is that he is not looking for how God is working. God is doing something different. In fact, as you'll see as we go along, Habakkuk isn't really believing that God's doing this. But God is. God is doing something in our own day. But here is what we would struggle to believe about God. Because you see, for he says, for I'm doing something in your own day. But here's what he says in verse 6. I am raising up the Babylonians. God is owning this. I am raising up the Babylonians, a cruel and violent people. They will march across the world and conquer other lands. They are notorious for their cruelty and do whatever they like. Their horses are swifter than cheetahs and fiercer than wolves at dusk. Their charioteers charge from far away. Like eagles, they swoop down to devour their prey. On they come, all bent on violence. Their hordes advance like a desert wind, sweeping captives ahead of them like sand. They scoff at kings and princes and scorn all their fortresses. They simply pile ramps of earth against their walls and capture them. They sweep past like the wind and are gone. But they are deeply guilty, for their strength is their God. Now you got to imagine Habakkuk is hearing this. And he's going, what? You're at work in these Babylonians? You know, think about this for a moment. You know, one of the things I commented about in my musing this week, if you got it, is that God is sovereign. We struggle with that. We like to think, yeah, you know, we're all in control, and we got it all figured out. Well, the world thought it had it all figured out on Tuesday, didn't they? Or at least Monday. Tuesday proved them wrong. And our God is in control. And here, we could be talking today about corrupt and immoral politicians. We could be talking about some of the organizations that are working so diligently and effectively to dismantle any semblance of biblical morality in America today. We could also be talking about terrorists. We could be talking about organizations that either homegrown or international that are seeking to destroy our way of life. We could be talking about outfits like ISIS or Al-Qaeda or whatever. History informs us that the Babylonians were a cruel and violent nation. They really were. Their army showed little in the way of mercy. But why? Weren't the Jews God's own people? Well, they thought they were. They embraced that as a cultural identity. But the reality was really something a lot different. You see, most of the Israelites had turned their back on God. What they offered God was a hypocritical religion. They talked about him with their lips, but they did not live for him with their lives. And so God is bringing the Babylonians. God is at work with a cruel and violent people. And we shake our heads and we go, how can that be? Well, if Judah will not fear God, then they will soon learn to fear a cruel and violent enemy that God is sending against them. You see, we all too often, we want to ask cold and cruel and look at all this violence. Why would God allow so much evil in our world today? Why would God allow so much violence in our world today? But you see, the same God who warns us throughout his word about the consequences of disobedience is the same God who allows that. Let me explain it this way. One of the things I think we struggle with, we look at evil, we look at wickedness, and we put it in the temporal vein. We want to say, you know, how could God allow such violence? How could he allow such cruelty? But all the while, what we're doing is we're not seeing the eternal. We're missing the eternal. You see, even as a believer in Christ, and if you saw this incredible movie we had Wednesday night, you saw a little bit about the suffering of Christians around the world. And you go, how could God allow that? Because our suffering for today is nothing compared to the glory that awaits us in the future. But you see, as good as the world may have it today, it is nothing compared to the eternal suffering and judgment of hell. And you see, God is showing us a dichotomy. He is bringing about, I believe God allows evil to remind us of our need for him. The air we breathe is not this world around us. It is the air from heaven. That is our hope. But you see, God loves you. God cares deeply about you, and God will do what he can to reach your heart. But you see, when we ignore, when we reject his revelation, when we reject his goodness and choose to ignore it, what we end up doing is sentencing ourselves to eternal damnation. And see, that's really what the Israelites were doing. They were rejecting their God. Well, they had a form of religion, but they didn't have a reality. And so, verse 12, Habakkuk says, "O Lord, my God, my Holy One, you who are eternal, surely you do not plan to wipe us out. O Lord, our rock, you have sent these Babylonians to correct us, to punish us for our many sins." Habakkuk's getting it. He understands what God is doing. He said, "Surely you're not going to destroy us." He says in verse 13, "But you are pure and cannot stand the sight of evil. You are purer eyes than to behold evil." And there are two incredible facets to this statement. One, Habakkuk rightly understands that evil or wickedness, sin, is incompatible with God. You know, we try to make God in our own image, that he's okay with our foolish and stupid sinful behaviors. Oh, God doesn't mind that. He knows me. No, God is of purer eyes than to look upon evil. And so Habakkuk, how could God use these wicked Babylonians? How could God use some of these politicians or even these terrorists? Why would he allow them? And we wrestle with that. We wrestle with what's going on in our country. We wrestle with what's going on in our world. We wrestle what's going on in our own communities. Maybe even in our own families. But then we also need to understand, secondly, that sin has no place in heaven. Habakkuk understands this. Unless sin is truly repented of, unless it is placed under the blood of Jesus Christ, as Habakkuk would have been looking towards, one will never, ever, ever see the peace and wonder of heaven. Beloved, it doesn't matter how good you are. Good people go to hell because they're not defined as good by God. They're defined as good by man. And we need to understand there's an eternal consequence for rejecting him. And with this in mind, he goes on to say, will you wink at their treachery? Should you be silent while the wicked, these evil Babylonians, swallow a people more righteous than they? And again, he's kind of almost doing the comparison, but he knows that good, godly people are going to be hurt. Verse 14, are we only fish to be caught and killed? Are we only sea creatures that have no leader? Must we be strung up on their hooks and caught in their nets while they rejoice and celebrate? How can God use such godless, wicked people? But he does. He does. We need to understand that all through history, God has done that. Because if we have no place for our God in our hearts, then he will bring godless people into our lives. He said, "You have no room for me? You have no place for me? Then I will give you what you're looking for. I will give you what you're asking for." What happens when people reject God? You see, they then suffer at the hands of the godless. Please do not misunderstand our God. I think one of the things we struggle with is we get caught up on something the Apostle John wrote. John wrote accurately that God is love. And we love that verse. I mean, oh, man, you know, I need to be loved. And we get all caught up on that, but that is not the sum of all that God is. You see, our God is also righteous. Our God is also holy. Our God cannot look upon wickedness. So there has to be an atonement. There has to be There has to be a way for us to come to know Christ. And that took a death on the cross. And it was the Son, Jesus Christ. Verse 16, then they will worship their nets and burn incense in front of them. These nets are the gods that have made us rich, they will claim. You know what's fascinating? He understands this. Habakkuk understands this. One of the things that he's picking up here is the Babylonians are going to become very boastful. We actually read about that in Daniel. When Nebuchadnezzar stood upon his palace and look at all that I have done. But you see, when godless people are successful, when they appear to be victorious, they think it's all about them. Why do I need God? Who needs God when I can wield such power, when I have such control? Even then, some will just seek to bend God to their own will. They'll refashion them according to their likeness. But can I share something with you? It's something I was thinking about. Every time, every victory that the godless win, everything that happens that takes away from, if you will, the liberty of the Christian. In other words, everything that detracts from our voice, our ability to come to the table, when we are shunted aside and cast aside as second-class citizens, when we are mocked and we are not given an equal chance at the table of our country. And by the way, that's happening. Please understand, this word tolerance, it is not defined the way you and I grew up understanding the word tolerance today. If you disagree with any of the godless, you are a bad person. Shame on you. But here's what's really sad and tragic about this. When you and I have our voice taken away from us, the enemy is so foolish they do not understand what they're doing. You see, the very thing that they are taking away from you and me someday will be taken away from them when godless and wicked rulers choose to take it away from them. You see, when we are robbed of our liberty, they will get robbed of theirs. You see, one of the things that fascinated me, I don't know if you were picking up on some of this in the news, maybe it's some of the news feeds I listen to, but recently, for example, on this the gay marriage issue and so on and so forth that's been going on, I have been really impressed with, actually, recently two articles came out from gay activists who basically said, we are doing this wrong. We are taking away from the freedom of speech of Christians and do not realize that someday this is going to come back to haunt us. They get it, but most do not. And by the way, there is an insanity to sinfulness that has no rhyme or reason. And so Habakkuk writes in verse 17, will you let them get away with this forever? Will they succeed forever in their heartless conquest? And so we find ourselves asking, is all this wickedness, this insanity, is it just going to go on and on and on? Is there not going to be an end to it? Can we not find someone who has some common sense, some moral fiber and decency to come up and speak for us? Well, Habakkuk's asking the same question. And so he says in chapter 2, verse 1, I will climb up to my watchtower and stand at my guard post. There I will wait to see what the Lord says and how he will answer my complaint. And Habakkuk says, God, I'm laying this before you. How are you going to answer? I'm struggling here. I'm wrestling with it. How are you going to address these concerns? Well, then the Lord said to me, verse 2, write my answer plainly on tablets so that a runner can carry the correct message to others. In other words, what God is saying, I'm going to be plain, Habakkuk. I'm going to be very plain, and it's going to be so simple that everyone can get it, but you need to listen for the correct message because not everyone is going to give it. Who are you listening to? Who are you paying attention to? He is being very simple, very plain. But he goes on to say, the vision is for a future time. It describes the end, and it will be fulfilled. If it seems slow in coming, wait patiently, for it will surely take place. It will not be delayed. You know, as certain as the Babylonian invasion was, so is Christ's return. You know, I don't know about you. I truly relate to this, or like I like to say, I resemble this. I don't think there is a day that goes by that at some level, some way, somehow in my prayer life, and because I believe in a pre-tribulational rapture of the church, I'm not asking God, that would be an awesome time. Beam me out. You know, I'm just like, wow, you know. But what happens is God is delaying. It's not happening on our timetable. It's happening on God's timetable. Our ways are not his ways, and our thoughts are not his thoughts. And God has his own plan, and he's working it. But he will come. And then he says, well, God continues, but look at the proud. They trust in themselves, and their lives are crooked. I love that they're crooked. They can't even walk in a straight line. They're messed up. But the righteous will live by their faithfulness to God. Over and over and over again in Scripture, we have written, but the righteous shall live by faith. The righteous shall live by faith. You see, those that are truly Christian will live a life of faith. It will not be a perfect life. It will not be a sinless life because we all struggle, but it will be a life whose persistent trajectory is one of faith, of trust. And God is encouraging Habakkuk with these words. Then God warns, though. He warns his prophet. He says, wealth is treacherous and the arrogant are never at rest. They open their mouths as wide as the grave, and like death, they are never satisfied. By the way, who is satisfied out there? You know, think about some of what's been going on in our country in the last few years. Think about, like, euthanasia or physician-assisted suicide. Think about, you know, redefining the family. Think about abortion. Think about any of these social issues that you can name, and you'll find it's never, ever enough. They're always taking it further, a little further, a little further. Beloved, do you not understand that what is freaky weird today will become fairly normal tomorrow? They open their mouths as wide as the grave, and like death, they are never satisfied. In their greed, they have gathered up many nations and swallowed many peoples. By the way, think about the United Nations today. Think about how so much of our society and the society of Europe has been creeping all throughout the world. You know, we lament, we are horrified by abortion. Beloved, the babies we kill in our nation are nothing compared to what happens in the world around us. I mean, it is all over. But soon the captives will taunt them. They will mock them, saying, what sorrow awaits you, thieves? Now you will get what you deserve. You become rich by extortion, but how much longer can this go on? Suddenly your debtors will take action. They will turn on you and take all that you have while you stand trembling and helpless. Because you have plundered many nations, now all the survivors will plunder you. You committed murder throughout the countryside and filled the towns with violence. What sorrow awaits you who build big houses with money gained dishonestly? You believe your wealth will buy security, putting your family's nest beyond the reach of danger. But by the murders you committed, you have shamed your name and forfeited your lives. The very stones in the walls cry out against you, and the beams in the ceilings echo the complaint. What sorrow awaits you who build cities with money gained through murder and corruption? Has not the Lord of heaven's armies promised that the wealth of nations will turn to ashes? They work so hard, but all in vain. And what's the verse that speaks to this? But our God is not mocked. For whatsoever a man sows, that shall he also reap. He who sows to the flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. See, this is what God is telling Habakkuk. He's saying, these wicked that you're so worried about, oh, they're going to be messed up. And by the way, can I tell you, history tells us that the Babylonians were. The Babylonians, after they wiped out Jerusalem, after they conquered and killed millions of Israelites, millions of Jews, and many of the people around them, they themselves were conquered by the Persians. Amazing. And so it goes through history. So it goes. For as the waters fill the sea, the earth will be filled with an awareness of the glory of God. You see, God does all this because he's trying to share with us. He's trying, and by the way, we're the ones who see it. The world does not, but he's trying to help the world see that God is God and they are not. You know, I really have to tell you something. You know, I don't know who you voted for, and it really doesn't matter, but I got to tell you something. I take such delight when the talking heads of TV are proved wrong. I love that. You guys are so stinking smart. No, you're not. You know, let my God mess with you. You know, let me show you who's God. You know, and I love that. I mean, I was surprised on Tuesday, or I guess it would be Wednesday morning. I was surprised when I woke up, like so many Americans were. But you know what I love more than anything? I could just see God going, oh, you think so? Well, let me show you who's boss. I just love that. I get such a kick out of that. But, you know, I believe that this speaks to, you know, the short-term reaping of what the enemy is of God sow, as well as eternal consequences. You know, how many times have we seen the lives and reputations of those who live for the flesh, the corrupt? How often have we seen them come to ruin? I mean, you know, it's really fascinating to me. You know, but even if not on this side of eternity, an eternal damnation and suffering awaits the unrepentant. You know, I don't wish God's eternal judgment on anyone. I really don't. But what I so appreciate the fact is we serve a righteous and holy God. And our God is in control. And then I love this verse 20. And skip down. It says, but the Lord is in his holy temple. Let all the earth be silent before him. You know what I love about this verse? It's like God is saying to the world, enough! Enough! Here's what he's saying to his prophet. Shh. I've got this. I've got this. Be still and know that I am God. You know, shush, my child. I've got a word of hope. You know, he goes on in verse 1. We have this word. The prayer was sung by the prophet Habakkuk. You know, here's Habakkuk's response to God's revelation. He's hearing God. He's listening to God. God is revealing things to him. And what does he do? He breaks out in song. This is praise. This is hallelujah. And he goes to verse 2, I've heard all about you, Lord. I am filled with awe by your amazing works. In this time of our deep need, help us again as you did in years gone by. And in your anger, remember your mercy. You know what's so amazing? God is reminding him of what he did in the past. Habakkuk had the word of God. He had the Old Testament up to that time. He had the words of his almighty God and what God did through history. He's saying, I know what you've done, God. Now remember us with mercy in your time of anger. He says, I see God moving across the deserts of Edom, the Holy One coming from Mount Paran. His brilliant splendor fills the heavens, and the earth is filled with his praise. His coming is as brilliant as the sunrise. Rays of light flash from his hands, where his awesome power is hidden. Pestilence marches before him. Plague follows close behind. When he stops, the earth shakes. When he looks, the nations tremble. He shatters the everlasting mountains and levels the eternal hills. He is the eternal one. He goes on, verse 10. The mountains watched and trembled. Onward swept the raging waters. The mighty deep cried out, lifting his hands in submission. Can you imagine the ocean going, "Uncle, I give up"? That's essentially what he's saying. The sun and the moon stood still in the sky as your brilliant arrows flew and your glittering spear flashed. You marched across the land in anger and trampled the nations in your fury. What Habakkuk is getting is a vision of his God. His God is irresistible. His God is a force that no man can overcome. He's saying God will have his way. My sovereign God is in control. I don't know where you were on Wednesday morning, but I can tell you where my God was on Wednesday morning. He was still on the throne. You know, and that's what he's understanding here. And he goes in verse 13, you went out to rescue your chosen people, to save your anointed ones. My God is a saving God. My God has your address. He loves you. He cares deeply about you. And he writes, you crushed the heads of the wicked and stripped their bones from head to toe. You know, when our Jesus comes back, it's not going to be for tea and crumpets. When he comes back, he is going to judge the wicked. It will not be pretty. He writes on verse 14, with his own weapons you destroyed the chief of those who rushed out like a whirlwind, thinking Israel would be easy prey. Again, the history of Babylon, yeah, Babylon was really literally, the city was taken in the night. It was sacked. Today, what our enemies sow, they will in turn reap. But you know what's sad and what's tragic? Often the very weapons that are used to harm us will be turned against our enemies. And again, they're too foolish to see it. You trampled the sea with your horses, verse 15, and the mighty waters piled high. I trembled inside when I heard this. My lips quivered with fear. My legs gave way beneath me, and I shook in terror. You see, here is the fear of God. You know, Habakkuk could have feared the Babylonians. The Babylonians were a wicked, powerful, almost unstoppable force in their day. But he sees God. He sees God. He sees God for who he is. Now, his fear is of his God. And it's not just a quaking fear I gotta hide. No, it's a fear that he is in the presence of the mightiest thing that man could ever comprehend, and we can't even comprehend God. And so he writes, I will wait quietly for the coming day when disaster will strike the people who invade us. You know, please understand, I want to pause here for just a moment. When Habakkuk wrote these words, the Babylonian invasion had not happened yet. God is prophesying what is to come. It is likely Habakkuk did in fact see the Babylonian invasion. He probably saw the sacking and destruction of Jerusalem and the temple. But he did not see God's judgment upon the Babylonians. He likely did not live that long. And he's saying, I will wait quietly for the coming day when disaster will strike the people who invade us. And he writes in verse 17, even though the fig trees have no blossoms and there are no grapes on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns are empty, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes me as sure-footed as a deer, able to tread upon the heights. You know, I have been on this earth for 60 years. I keep thinking any day now Christ is going to return, and he is not. How many of you or even older than me, how many of us had parents and grandparents who longed for the return of Christ? You see, we don't know when God is returning. God does not promise us a world of abundance and ease and pleasure. What he promises is himself. What he promises us is peace in him. But that is predicated upon faith in him. I don't know what tomorrow is going to bring. I don't know it any more than you know it. You know, I would like to say that as of Tuesday, we now have some hope. I'm not holding my breath. I'm really not. Because too many people have let you and me down over the years. Some of them people we love, some people we care about. Some we don't know, but we've invested a lot of trust. But please understand, there was only one Messiah, and his name is Jesus Christ. There was only one Savior. You know, and I have hope because of who he is. I can look to tomorrow because I know that he has been, and he's already there. You know, one of the amazing things about my God, he isn't just relegated to the past. He's not even just relegated to the present. My God is already in the future. We don't get that. That's kind of hard to wrap our heads around, but he's already there. He's already there. And so when something happens today and we go, oh, whoa, God says, I knew that. I knew that. Now, will you trust me? Will you trust me? So I know a lot of you guys are probably struggling right now, and I get that. I am too. In my humanity, I am struggling. I don't know what's going to happen. I don't know what's going to happen with the Supreme Court. I don't know what's going to happen in Harrisburg. I don't know what's going to happen in Washington. I don't know what's going to happen around the world. I don't know. But I do know this. My God is sovereign. And I want to quote this again. Even though the fig trees have no blossoms and there are no grapes on the vines, even though the olive crop fails and the fields lie empty and barren, even though the flocks die in the fields and the cattle barns empty, think about this. Though your retirement account fails, though you lose your job, your house burns down, though our government becomes anti-Christian, and we are robbed of our liberty. I mean, I could go on and on and on. And please understand something. This is what Habakkuk was dealing with. This is not some guy who's hanging out in a palace sipping lattes. This guy is going through what we're going through. And he says, yet I will rejoice in the Lord. I will be joyful in the God of my salvation. The sovereign Lord is my strength. He makes me as sure-footed as a deer and to tread upon the heights. And then in the last words of this beautiful passage, he says, for the choir director, this prayer is to be accompanied by stringed instruments. Well, you know what, Dave? I think we ought to accompany this with stringed instruments. What do you think? Beloved, this is a high praise for a man of God, for his God, in very uncertain times. Now what? Now what? The answer is God. It's always been God. Let's rest in confidence in him. Please stand and join me as we have a word of prayer and our worship team comes forward. Our most gracious Heavenly Father, God, I thank you that your word is alive, that it is powerful, and that it speaks to us even today. Especially today. Lord, sometimes we think that our Bibles have no relevance to who and what we are today, but it does. Oh, it does. It speaks to us in so many ways. But the end of all of this is we can have comfort and hope in you. Lord, you have said in your word, we shall know the truth, and the truth shall set us free. Are we free? Are you free? Because I know, God, you want us all to be free. Maybe not within the culture we live in, but we can be free in our hearts. You can give us something that no man, no power, no government can ever take away. And that is our relationship with you. Lord, is my prayer that if one here is here today and does not know you as their Savior and Lord, if they are just quivering with fear and anxiousness and doubts, and Lord, help them to know freedom that comes from having a relationship with you. For Christianity is truly not a religion. It is a relationship. It is a relationship of hope and of promise and of salvation. And so our altar is open. Maybe some of us need to come and pray. Maybe some of us need to praise you. But let us all recognize that we will rejoice in the God of our salvation. In your precious name we pray. Amen.